Hello everyone, good morning. I am Dr. Bhupendra Saha, Assistant Professor of Department of Internal Medicine, BP Koirala Institute of Health Science, Dhara, Nepal. So today we'll discuss and learn something about the acute pancreatitis. This presentation is basically for the sixth semester MBBS student and may be useful for the other MBBS student as well. And let us discuss about the acute pancreatitis. So what we are going to discuss in today's presentation, we'll define the acute pancreatitis, we'll discuss about the epidemiology, pathophysiology, and etiologies of the acute pancreatitis. And we'll also discuss about the clinical presentation, how you are supposed to work up the patient with acute pancreatitis. We'll just discuss a little bit about the severity scoring system of the acute pancreatitis. In the last part of the presentation, we'll discuss about the complications, treatment, and the prognosis of the acute pancreatitis. So, what is pancreatitis? You people know, I think, because where there is a titis, then you will always think it's the inflammation. So pancreatitis is the inflammation of the pancreas, which is associated with the injury to the exocrine parenchyma of the pancreas. We know by our knowledge of anatomy that pancreas has two parts. One is endocrine part and another one is the exocrine part. And in a patient with acute pancreatitis, there is a injury to the exocrine parenchyma. So it is usually is inflammation. It's not an infection, that you have to know, okay? It's an inflammation. So epidemiologically, when we collect the research of the acute pancreatitis, we see the male are like having more risk factors to develop the acute pancreatitis than female. When you look at the etiology, the alcohol is the most common cause of acute pancreatitis in male, whereas female, it's the biliary tract disease secondary to the gallstone. Okay, so what are the etiologies of acute pancreatitis? There are list of acute causes of acute pancreatitis. My dear student, you have to remember the two important etiology of acute pancreatitis. One is alcohol and second one is gallstone disease. Most of the patient who get admitted in the medicine ward because of acute pancreatitis, most of them have the alcohol as the etiology of acute pancreatitis. Whereas the gallstone pancreatitis are often get admitted in the surgery ward. There are some other rare causes of acute pancreatitis like mechanical injury to the pancreas by the ERCP procedure. This is the new procedure coming up. And the medications like thiazide diuretics, azathioprine, sulfonamide can rarely cause the acute pancreatitis. And one important conditions that can cause acute pancreatitis is hypertriglyceridemia. If someone has the triglyceride level of more than 1000, they are more prone to have the acute pancreatitis. And infection, you know, so viral infection like mumps virus, which also causes the bilateral pancreatitis, that same virus can cause the acute pancreatitis. But despite working out for this so many etiologies, sometimes we fail to get the exact etiology of acute pancreatitis, then we label that condition as a idiopathic acute pancreatitis. Okay, for the exam purpose, you need to mug up these etiologies, but for practically, don't ever forget alcohol and gallstone as the two most common cause of acute pancreatitis. Okay. Then what is the pathogenesis of acute pancreatitis? It's a complex picture. It is adapted from the Robbins and Quattrum. So there are basically three important mechanisms, three important causes. One is duct obstruction, pancreatic duct obstruction. Another one is acinar cell injury, direct injury to the acinar cell. Third one is defective intracellular transport. Duct obstruction can be caused by the cholelithiasis, ampullary obstruction, but acinar cell injury is caused by the alcohol, drugs, some viruses, and defective intracellular transport is caused by the alcohol or sometimes metabolic injuries. But overall, the causes may be the different, but the ultimate result is the acinar cell injury, in that injury to the exocrine pancreas, which activate the enzymes in the pancreas itself. You know, the pancreatic enzyme are the proenzyme. They have to come to the intestine to get activated. But if there are these type of problems, then these enzymes can activate it in pancreas itself and cause the different sort of problem, and can cause the acute pancreatitis. Okay. Now, what are the clinical features? As a physician, we admit so many cases of acute pancreatitis in our ward. And most of the patients with acute pancreatitis present to the emergency room with a history of abdominal pain. Some patients may have mild pain, but as far as my experience, most of the patients have the moderate to severe abdominal pain, and then that pain has some characteristic nature that usually occur in the epigastrium, may radiate to the back and to the whole abdomen, usually get aggravated by food intake. Okay, and one of the classical feature is the pain of the acute pancreatitis get aggravated on lying down position, whereas they get relief in taking the propped up position, like this position. Okay. And the associated symptoms, what we see in our day-to-day practice, are most of the patient with acute pancreatitis has a feature of the nausea, vomiting, abdominal distension, not passing stool and flatus. These are the associated features of acute pancreatitis. If it is more severe, then they will have the other clinical picture as well, as like shortness of breath. When you do the physical examination, on the general physical examination, when you see the patient in the emergency, they looks to have pain, and the vitals, BP, usually low, because there can be hypotension because of the third space blood loss. Respiration usually rapid because of these different pulmonary complications and acidosis that can occur in pancreatitis. Temperature may be elevated for initial 2 to 3 days, because it's the acute inflammatory process, the temperature can be elevated. Okay. Saturation there can be decrease in saturation. These are the general physical examination finding, and you should never forget to check the jaundice and the dehydration level. You should never forget, because these may be the one of the general physical examination finding that can get in a patient with acute pancreatitis. On doing systemic examination, you have to examine abdomen properly, where you can get the distended abdomen. You can get the tenderness in the epigastric region, absent bowel sounds. Okay, these are the clinical picture that you can get. And depending upon the complication, you may get the clinical feature of other symptoms, other system as well. Okay. Then what are the, I think I'll just discuss these two important, interesting, not so much common, clinical sign. Okay, this is the great honor sign here. So you see the hemorrhagic spot in the flank of your patient. This is a great honor sign. And if you see the this hemorrhagic spot around the umbilicus, this is called the Kulin sign. And if you see such type of hemorrhagic spot in around the inguinal region, that's called the Fox sign. These are interesting but rare. And usually you will get in a patient with hemorrhagic pancreatitis. Okay, may come in your MCQ. Okay. Okay. So till now we have discussed what is the definition of pancreatitis. It's the inflammation of exocrine pancreas. What is two most important cause? Alcohol and gallstone. What are the clinical features? Abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting, these are the clinical features. What are the complications of this acute pancreatitis? We have to divide into local and the systemic complications. Local complications, there may be the pancreatic fluid collections, which may be sterile. Sometimes it may be infected, but most of the time it's a sterile fluid collection. Sometimes it may, this fluid can be infected and can turn into the abscess. There can be a necrosis. And sometimes in some of the patient you will get cirrhosis, but this is one of the chronic complications of acute pancreatitis. You'll see after 3-4 weeks. Okay. Okay, these are the local complications that you should be aware of. And in the systemic complication in the cardiovascular, patient can have the hypotension, they can have different types of edema, and they can develop the pericardial effusion. Similarly, they can have ERDS and pleural effusion. Because of third space fluid loss, they can have acute kidney injuries. They can have hyperglycemia as well as hypocalcemia. In the CNS, some of the patient can go into the encephalopathy. Okay, these are the complications of the acute pancreatitis. You should be aware because you have to monitor in your patient. Okay. So what are the differential diagnosis? The differential diagnosis, there are a list of differential diagnosis. The important differential diagnosis in my clinical experiences, one of the important clinical is peptic ulcer. Peptic ulcer can mimic the acute pancreatitis. Another is cholecystitis. Cholecystitis can just mimic the acute pancreatitis. Don't forget these two diseases. In this systemic condition, don't forget about diabetes ketoacidosis, especially in the background of diabetes mellitus. Don't ever forget the diabetes ketoacidosis. And similarly, don't forget about the MI, because some of the patients with acute pancreatitis may have MI and can present with the epigastric pain. In case of female, don't forget about the salpingitis or ectopic pregnancy. Okay. So how we are going to diagnose a patient with acute pancreatitis? We are going to diagnose the acute pancreatitis. For that, we need to have the knowledge of the three important criteria for the acute pancreatitis. One is the abdominal pain, which is consistent with the acute pancreatitis. What is the number one criteria? Symptoms, that is abdominal pain. Number two, biochemical, that is elevation in serum amylase or lipase. Okay. Third is characteristic finding from abdominal imaging. And ultrasound is the imaging of choice in the emergency room. Okay. It is non-invasive and it is safe. You can see, you can do the ultrasound and can see the anatomy of the pancreas. But problem with the ultrasound is sometimes if there is a gaseous distension of the abdomen, and it may be difficult to look at the pancreas. So if out of these three criteria, if two criteria is met, then we can say it's the case of acute pancreatitis. Okay? Okay. Now let us discuss something about these two enzymes, amylase and lipase. Amylase is the enzyme which rises early and which falls early. So usually amylase returns to the normal level by the end of 3 to 5 days of the onset of acute pancreatitis. If there is an elevation of the amylase after 5 days, then you have to suspect some local complication of the pancreatitis. Okay. Similarly, lipase elevated later on, but it persists for like longer duration, for 10 to 12 days. So you can do any of these tests, but you have to know the significance of elevation and when they dropped later on. Okay, but always remember, pancreatitis is not the only one condition where you will see the elevation of serum amylase and lipase. That's why you need to analyze the patient very, very carefully, very, very carefully. So which diagnosis imaging you want to prefer? I often ask in the round, if patient like, if affordable, if they can afford any test, what test you want to do in the emergency? And most of them say, sir, CT scan. No, CT scan is not a investigation or imaging of choice in the emergency, because when you are doing the CT scan, you have to know, you have to give the oral contrast, and that contrast can block the pancreatic duct and further aggravate the complication. One, second is CT scan basically look for the complications and the necrosis. And to develop complication necrosis, it need time, at least 2 to 3 days. So we often do the CT scan in a patient after 3 days, if it is really required. Otherwise, we don't do even CT. Okay. Okay. Then there are so many scoring systems. So Bass, Ranson, Glasgow, Bicep, so many. If it's good if you know the scoring system. My recommendation is just read about Bicep score. This is a new scoring system, very good and very easy scoring system. Bicep means, B means, you know, it's the blood, urea, nitrogen more than 22. I means impaired mental status. S means source 2x4. Age means more than 60 years. P means pleural effusion. If out, you have to give one for each score. And if it is 5, then it's a 9.5% mortality. By this way, we can prognosticate the patient with acute pancreatitis. Okay, Bicep score. Okay, remember. Now, till now, we have defined acute pancreatitis. Now we know what are the etiologies, what are the clinical features, what are the lab investigations, what are the complications of the acute pancreatitis. Now we have to treat our patient. Okay, so how you are going to treat the patient? See, the initial management, when someone comes to your emergency room, then we have to definitely check for the airway, breathing and circulation. That is for all the patient in the emergency. But for the patient with acute pancreatitis, we have to keep them NPO, meal per oral, because we have to give rest to the pancreas. We have to obtain the vital signs frequently, because they can have complications and they can die just in front of your eyes. That's why you need to monitor the five different vital signs. And where to admit, if it is a case of severe acute pancreatitis, if patient had a labored respiration, if they are hypotensive, if there is a drop in saturation, if they required the adequate amount of fluid replacement, then they need to get admitted in the ICU. Otherwise, we often admit the patient in ward inpatient. Yeah. Now we have decided where to admit. Then we have to manage two things while managing a patient with acute pancreatitis. One is pain, second is fluid. Okay. Pain, because there is the abdominal pain is the number one clinical symptoms. That's why you have to give pain. Which analgesic you want to give? We often give the parenteral narcotics. You can try morphine or meperidine. There are so many controversies regarding these drugs, but the latest recommendation is you can use these drugs. But what we often use in the ward is you use tramadol as an analgesic. Okay, tramadol we give to the patient for the pain management. Okay. Then regarding the fluid in acute pancreatitis, what do you think, which fluid we are supposed to give? So we give Ringer lactate to a patient with acute pancreatitis. Someone can argue with normal saline, but Ringer lactate is more physiological. That's why he give ringer lactate. Okay, we give ringer lactate for the patient. How much? So we want the urine output of our patient to be more than 0.5 ml per kg per hour. Okay, so we have to monitor the urine. Okay, and our target, what is our target? If someone has the severe acute pancreatitis, and most of the time we see the raised level of hematocrit, and our target is to decrease that hematocrit level to maintain the blood pressure. That's our target. And we have to be always be aware about the complications regarding excessive fluid administration. Okay, ringer lactate is the fluid of choice that you need to remember. What about the nutrition? As I've already told, we usually keep the patient in oral, but if you keep the patient near part oral for the long time, then what happens? Most of the time, there are so many organisms in the intestinal lumen, and that can proliferate it, and they translocate to our system, and that gives more complications. So we cannot keep the patient in NPO for the long and long time. We have to reassess the patient after at least 48 hours, and we have to do the APACHE scoring. And regarding the internal nutrition, most of the gastroenterologists recommend the internal nutrition because it stabilizes the gut barrier. It reduces the translocation of the organism from the intestinal lumen. What we have to do, we have to put the NG, and we have to put the another tip of the NG up to jejunum, nasojejunal feeding we can give. Okay, and parenteral feeding is often not recommended. Okay, so when we should initiate the oral intake, because your patient wants to take orally. So we'll ask, do you want to take orally? Yes, one is desire of the patient. And if there is no pain, with no analgesic, and without giving analgesic, if there is no pain, then you can try. If there is no tenderness, if the bowel sounds is present, then you can try the oral feeding. Okay. So what about the antibiotics? This is, I think, one of the wrong practice that we people do in different places. Prophylactic antibiotics is not required in acute pancreatitis, because as I have already told, it is a sterile inflammation. It's not an infection. That's why you're giving antibiotics. Okay, so it's not required. You can try antibiotics only if you see there is the local fluid collection in the pancreas. If you suspect the infection is going on, if you can take out the sample, and if you can prove there is an organism, then you can give, you have to give the antibiotics. Okay, so the antibiotic of choice in a patient with acute pancreatitis is carbapenem, and we often give the imipenem cilastin combination because it can penetrate the pancreatic tissues. No other antibiotic can penetrate the pancreatic tissue. That's why if we suspect the infection in a patient with acute pancreatitis, then we have to give the imipenem cilastin combination. Okay, so when to discharge? If everything is well, then you can discharge. If patient there is no pain with oral analgesia, you can discharge. If all the complications have been addressed, if your patient can tolerate the oral diet nicely, then you can discharge the patient. Okay, then I think this is the last slide for the today's presentation. What are the take-home messages? So acute pancreatitis is the acute inflammation of the exocrine pancreas. Acute inflammation of exocrine pancreas. Alcohol and gallbladder are the two most common causes of acute pancreatitis. Abdominal pain is the most common symptoms. Ultrasound and serum amylase or lipase will suffice the diagnosis of acute pancreatitis. Nilparoral management of pain with narcotic analgesic and IV fluid with ringer lactate are the cornerstone of the management of the acute pancreatitis. Thank you. Thank you so much for your kind attention. If you have any queries, you can write in the comment section. I'm happy to answer. Goodbye. Stay safe.